All right, you crazy hate kids. Well, almost messed that up. Here's your introduction to chemical bonding or intramolecular forces. So we have 9 compounds in front of you. At first glance, we have some differences. Like I see like solids, another solid, ooh, a liquid. Here's a gas. All right, some different stuff in front of you. I see some different ratios. Here's like a subscript 2, meaning 2 chlorines, 2 phosphoruses, just a bunch of gold. So what do these things have in common, though? And how would you name these things? So I know what they have in common, but maybe you don't. I can see some similarities. I look at this first one, and I see that this is a metal, and those are all metals, and they're bonded with nonmetals. Because I have a metal and a nonmetal, believe it or not, that makes it ionic. And because I have a metal and a nonmetal, and ionic bonds are a thing, that means that these are all going to be solid at room temperature. That is a property of ionic bonds. Our next one down, we can see that we have 2 nonmetals. When I have 2 nonmetals bonded together, that's going to be covalent. And because it's covalent bonds, I have the ability to be gaseous at room temperature, or sometimes liquid room temperature. But mostly covalent things are gaseous at room temperature. And then last but not least, I see that I have just metals. When you have just metals, it is going to be metallic bonding. I don't need a different element to be bonded with it, because I literally have a big pile of gold here. I have thousands upon thousands of gold atoms all bonded together. What type of bond? Well, it's a metallic bond that's holding those atoms together. All right, let's look. Oh, also, most metals are solid room temperature. There's one that's not. Mercury, you already know that. Bond properties. So, depending upon the bond type, you have a certain amount of properties. The very first one you should notice is that whether or not it's solid, liquid, or gas is dependent upon the bond type. And we're talking about at room temperature. In the grand scheme of things, anything can be a solid, liquid, or gas, but we always compare it to room temperature. So at room temperature, covalent things can be gaseous and liquid. Ionic things are always solid, and metallic things are almost always solid except for mercury. And then technically all bonds have some ionic, covalent, and metallic character. What I mean by that is that this isn't purely ionic, all right? Salt, you know, it's the most common ionic bond to talk about, or NaCl. There's still a little bit of covalentness in salt and metallicness in salt, all right? So just because I'm calling it ionic doesn't mean it's 100% ionic. There's a little overlap between your intramolecular forces. An example of this would be like Darth Vader. So Darth Vader, everyone would say like, oh, he's evil. He's actually a little good, all right? So even though Darth Vader, this like evil villain, is categorized as evil, he's still a little good. All right, so here we have ionic, covalent, metallic. I already mentioned this, but here it is written down for you. Metals, nonmetals, 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 and just metals. And then one more fun fact about ionic and covalent things are the ratio of atoms present. If we look up top here, I see that I have a 1-to-2 ratio from magnesium to chlorine. Believe it or not, that's the only ratio that can possibly exist between magnesium and chlorine. Nothing else is possible. All right, we'll talk about why in a little bit, but with ionic things, the ratio is set in stone. You cannot change the ratio of the metals to the nonmetals. It's impossible. With covalent things, though, I can change the ratio. An example would be CO2. CO2, carbon dioxide, is a thing. You breathe it out. However, carbon monoxide also exists. So that's a different ratio between the carbons and oxygens. So with covalent bonds, the ratio between the atoms can change, but with ionic bonds, the ratio between the atoms cannot change. Big difference between the two. I have here, it's set in stone because most rocks are ionic. They're stone. I thought it was funny, whatever. All right, let's jump into some definitions. We have a chemical bond is a mutual electrical attraction between nuclei and valence electrons of different atoms that binds the atoms together. Believe it or not, this entire universe is all about positives and negatives, okay? Anytime you see anything bonded with anything else, it's because of positives and negatives. And it's about those outer shell electrons, valence electrons, and the positive centers of the atoms. That's all it is. Okay, we have some definitions we've talked about before, but we were going to talk about them again. Valence electrons, you guys know about those, the outer shell electrons. Those are the ones that we can lose, shared, or gain in chemical reactions. Those are the ones we really care about. On the periodic table, we can quickly identify how many valence electrons we have in the S and P blocks, our main group elements. You count to 8 from left to right, skip D block, no big deal. The octet rule is something we've learning about right now, I guess. Atoms are stable when they have 8 electrons on their highest energy level. The highest energy level is your main group elements, S and P. So if I add up 2 and 6, I would get 8. So when they have 8 electrons, or they have the electron configuration of a noble gas, they become very stable. There are many, many exceptions to this. I'm going to have you learn about 3, hydrogen, helium, and boron. Hydrogen's octet is only 2 electrons. Helium's octet is only 2 electrons. Why? No, because they're both in the first energy level, and that can only hold 2 electrons, so that's why their octet is what it is. Boron's is only 6 electrons. Don't worry about why for now, just memorize that its octet only has 6 instead of the usual 8. As more of a review, cations are metals, positive ions, they lose electrons to become stable. Anions, nonmetals, negative ions, gain electrons to be more stable. Cool. Now, let's jump into it. We have major types of intramolecular forces. Don't get confused between intra and intermolecular. Intermolecular forces, we'll talk about later. We're talking about intramolecular forces right now. So, covalent, ionic, and metallic. These are the big 3. Covalent, by definition, the sharing of electron pairs from 2 atoms. It's always a pair of electrons that's being shared. Okay? So, how that's possible is the orbitals of these atoms overlap. The overlapping allows the electrons to be in more than one location, which is kind of neat. They can be next to one atom or be next to a different atom. It's like the atoms are kind of holding hands and they're sharing their hands together. That's a weird example, but I'm going to leave it. Okay. Ionic bonding results from the electrical attraction between large numbers of cations and anions. The overall charge of an ionic compound is neutral. I don't know why, but everybody always forgets that. Remember that you can't have a positive ionic bond or an ionic compound or a negative ionic compound. The overall charge has to be 0. So your total positives have to equal your total negatives. Just one of those things. Another big difference, notice I say large numbers of cations and anions. I can have a covalent bond legit between 2 atoms. I cannot have that with ionic bondings. I need billions upon trillions of cations and anions to make it work. So that's a big difference between the two. Metallic bonding between metals themselves. Our next lecture is actually going to be ionic and Our next lecture is going to be about ionic and metallic bonding more in depth. So even though I'm going over it quickly now, realize we're going to talk about it again. But I'm not going to go into metallic right now. Why are there different types of bonds? Well, it all stems from differences in electronegativity. So, electronegativity is table A, I believe, in your packet. Or if you open it up and on the back of the periodic table, you'll see these little selected elements with values of 0 to 4. We have already talked about this. They're electronegative values. But really, the differences between the atoms' electronegative values determines bond type. So, when two atoms are going to bond together, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at their electronegative values. Depending upon the difference, actually, we can determine bond type. As a general rule, up here is very true. Okay, so ionic is metal and nonmetal, covalent is nonmetal and nonmetal, and metallic is metal. However, there are actually 2 types of covalent bonds. So if I run into a situation when I have a covalent bond, I then I'm going to have to do some math about what their differences in electronegativity is going to be, and then it'll determine my bond type for that. And that's polar versus nonpolar. But I jumped ahead 1 second. So, if I have a high difference in electronegative values, that means it's ionic. A low difference, it's covalent. Why would a high difference in electronegative values be ionic? Well, if I have an atom here and an atom here, we'll call it atom A and atom B, and I have an electron here and an electron here. If B is very electronegative, okay, so very electronegative, maybe A, it's fluorine with a value of 4.0, that means it's going to be attracted to this electron right here. And it's going to be so attracted to it, it's actually going to steal it. And it's going to pull it away because it's so very attracted to it. That's going to make B negative and A positive, or the formation of a cation and anion. We'll get into that more, but that's basically what it's all about. If there's a low difference between the two, if I have A and B, and I have an electron here, an electron here, it's not like B is really attracted to the electrons or A is really attracted to the electrons. So what can happen there is these electrons can actually be shared between the atoms. Well, I'm having a hard time doing that. All right, so they can go over here or they can go over here. They can be shared by overlapping orbitals, which is kind of neat. Okay, nonpolar versus polar covalent bonds. I have to look at the electronegative differences between the atoms that are being bonded together. A nonpolar covalent bond is when you're going to have electrons that are equally shared between the atoms. This would be like if I had four quarters and I gave two of them to you and I kept two, and the quarters would be represented by electrons, or the electrons are represented by quarters rather. That's an even sharing of those electrons. When I have an electronegative difference of 0.0 to 0.4, we're going to call that a nonpolar covalent bond. Understand that this value of 0.4 is just for your reference in this class. It's not set in stone. It's a made-up value, but it's going to help you determine bond type. And we're going to leave it at that. When you take AP next year, and yes, I'm making all of you take AP, it gets more in-depth. But for right now, we're going to use this value of 0.4. And I'm going to show you some examples to make this make more sense. But when I have that value from 0.0 to 0.4, we're going to call that a nonpolar covalent bond, meaning the electrons are shared equally between the atoms. If I have a value that's equal to or greater than 0.4, I'm going to call that a polar covalent bond, meaning the electrons are no longer shared evenly. So if I had atom A and atom B, and the electronegative difference between the two was like 0.9, that's over my threshold of 0.4, and whoever's more electronegative, let's pretend like B was more electronegative, that means the electrons are going to spend more time around B compared to A, making B have a slightly negative charge and A have a slightly positive charge. That means it's polar. Remember that I said that all bonds are a mix, okay? So nothing is purely ionic covalent. Nothing's, you know, nonpolar, polar. These things we use to kind of explain the differences between bond types, but they all kind of overlap. There's something called ionic character out there. If you have a very low ionic character, we call that nonpolar. If you have a little bit of ionic character, we call that polar, covalent here. And if you have a lot of ionic character, then we call you ionic. Okay, but realize it's a mix. It's not just like one thing or the other. We're gonna dive into three examples, and hopefully these three examples help you along the way with our different types of bonds. And then, like I said, you're gonna have more lectures on these specific types of intermolecular forces. Our next one's going to be ionic and metallic, and then we're going to spend some time on covalent. So we have more lectures on this. I know I've gone pretty fast. Let's look at sodium and chlorine. So I know right away what type of bond I'm dealing with, because sodium's a metal and chlorine's a nonmetal. Therefore, this has to be ionic. I know what's going to happen, but we're going to take a look at what's going to happen in terms of our math and electron configuration and what actually occurs just for fun. If I look at my electronegative differences, my difference is 2.1. That's a very large difference. Understanding that the highest difference can be 4.0, because our electronegative scale goes from 0 to 4. So if I have something that's a 0 and something that's a 4, that's the biggest difference you're going to have. All right, let's look at what's going to occur here. I know that sodium is going to form a cation, and I know that chlorine is going to form an anion. I know this because sodium is a metal, and that's what happens to metals. If we look at the electron configuration, this outermost electron is our valence electron. And these 7 valence electrons are the valence electrons for chlorine. You can probably see what's going to happen here in that this valence electron is going to be stolen by chlorine. When it's stolen by chlorine, that means that it's gone from sodium. Sodium develops a positive 1 charge, and take a look now. It has a full outer shell of electrons, or 8 valence electrons. It has an octet. It becomes very stable. Chlorine now, I'm going to remove that electron and put it here. I now have 6. Its highest level now also has 8. It has an octet. It has a negative charge. I can show that with dot notation as well. And what's going to happen is this electron right here is going to be stolen away and transferred over to chlorine. This makes sodium positive, and this makes chlorine negative. That's an ionic bond. Remember, this isn't just one sodium and one chlorine. It's billions upon trillions of these things all happening at the same time. And then I'm going to have an attraction between these positives and these negatives, which makes the whole thing kind of stick together. Cool. Let's look at another example. Our next example is hydrogen and hydrogen. So H2 is a thing. You guys already know that because it's a diatomic. But let's explain why. My electronegative difference is zero. So right away, I can identify this as a nonpolar covalent bond because I've looked at the differences in electronegativity and I realize that hydrogen is a nonmetal. So when I have two nonmetals bonded together, it's going to be covalent. My difference is 0.0 makes this a nonpolar bond. How does this thing work? How does H2 a thing? If I overlap these orbitals, these electrons actually can jump back and forth and give each one of those hydrogens an octet. You're going to be sharing a pair of electrons. We show that by taking one of these electrons that should be up here. Oh, no. One of these electrons, trying. Here we go. Putting it here. Another one of these electrons. Circle it. Grab it. There we go. Putting it here. And then taking my hydrogen and putting it here. Now, each one of these hydrogens has an octet, because their octet is only two electrons. They're sharing that pair of electrons between their two. Cool. That's how it works. Here's another one. Our last one. Hydrogen and chlorine. If we look at our differences in electronegativity, we see that our difference comes out to be 0.9. 0.9 is a pretty significant difference. In fact, it's greater than our threshold of 0.4, making this a polar covalent bond. I know it's covalent because these are two nonmetals. So that's another way to identify it, but I need to identify it further with our differences in electronegativity, which makes it a polar covalent bond. I'm still gonna have the sharing of electrons, but I've written this little script here. Chlorine is more electron greedy. Electrons are going to spend more time near chlorine. Chlorine then has a slight negative charge, kind of like an anion, and hydrogen has a slight positive charge, kind of like a cation. So this electron here is going to go over here, and we're going to show that that electron is shared between the hydrogen and the chlorine. They both have octets, true, but that electron is actually going to spend more time near the chlorine. So this side of this little molecule is going to be having a slightly negative charge, and this side is going to have a slightly positive charge. In chemistry, we draw a dipole to show those charges. The dipole looks like this little arrowy thing. So it indicates a polar bond and direction of charge. It points to the more electronegative atom. So when I have my hydrogen, and it's bonded to my chlorine, shown here, they both have octets. I'm going to draw a dipole next to it that points in the direction of the more electronegative element. That tells everybody else that this side has a negative partial charge and this side has a positive partial charge. So those are your three examples of an ionic, a polar covalent, and a nonpolar covalent bond. We're going to spend a lot more time on this. This is simply an intro. Hopefully you enjoyed it.